we can be possessive in terms of our intrusiveness.
I want some nice boobs, but
we can be possessive in terms of our intrusiveness towards other people, our desire to understand them, to get them into our framework, push them into our categories. Our desire to understand them, to get them into our framework, push them into our categories. And her whole ministry, seems to me, is very deeply shot through with this non-possessiveness. She begins, remember, as someone who is ministering to people like herself, Russian refugees. And imperceptibly, it morphs into caring for strangers, people of another race and religion.
I control all your thoughts and all your moves. I'm in the Illuminati. I'm in the Illuminati. I'm in the Illuminati. I'm in the Illuminati.
And imperceptibly, it morphs into caring for strangers, people of another race and religion, and regarding them with the same deep respect and love.
Good evening, Rowan. It's the 13th of May 2018 and it's about 11 p.m. And obviously this is my usual Sunday evening video to reassure you that I haven't been seducing any priests over the weekend, so you can relax. Nor have I been hanging round the Catholic parish of St Urban's, hoping to bump into any pretend astrophysicists in order to save your skin. And nor have I come out as a lesbian in order to save your gigantic ego. So everything is exactly the same as usual. Nothing ever changes. Anyway, I thought we could carry on with our chat, following on immediately from where I left off in my last video, where we were talking about a lecture that you gave to a gathering of ministers of the United Reformed Church in Britain, which took place on the 30th of April 2018. So this is the first of three lectures. It's so entertaining. I'm still talking about the first one. I haven't even moved on to the others yet. And you've also given more talks since then as well, but this one is just so entertaining. So in this first lecture from the 30th of April, you're talking about Maria Skoptsova, who was a Russian Orthodox nun. So here we are, following on from exactly where I left off. This is part two, so you say. And she says that if you attempt to hold on to your inner life at the expense of this openness, eh? Now, what could you be talking about then, given that you're a pervert? And she says that if you attempt to hold on to your inner life at the expense of this openness, we know what this idea leads to. We know the egoism that can reign in the world. Oh, you mean like globalist egoism, where the globalists want to take over the whole world and eliminate everyone else, and they're using the environment as an excuse, environmental protection, but really they just want to own all the land and resources of the earth themselves. So the egoism that can reign in the world, you're talking about that then, and the egoism of their useful idiots like you. We know what this idea leads to. We know the egoism that can reign in the world. We know how people's care for their spiritual peace. You're having a snipe at me here, aren't you? Obviously, that's going to make me capitulate instantly and give you everything that you want and save your skin. Just like it has every other time you've had a snipe at me. We know how people's care for their spiritual peace. They're locking themselves away. Well, I'm not locking myself away. I've been locked away, really. I'm only locking myself away from constant harassment and persecution, which has been perpetrated at your behest in order to try and drive me to suicide and save your skin. We know how people's care for their spiritual peace, they're locking themselves away, leads before our eyes to self-poisoning. Well, I haven't poisoned myself. I've been forcibly poisoned by other people, and you're poison. You are poison. You don't just minister it. You are poison. So, this leads before our eyes to self-poisoning, demoralisation and loss of joy. So the purpose of your hate campaign against me, which has now been going on since 1992, at least, has been, it's been a systematic campaign of demoralisation, trying to make me lose my faith, lose confidence in myself, and either become very easy to manipulate and push around, or to drive me to suicide. And you'd prefer that, because then you'd be able to shut me up permanently. So, this care for spiritual peace and locking themselves away leads before our eyes to self-poisoning, demoralisation and loss of joy. So, in your parlance, the words joy and sex are virtually synonymous. And I've shown an example of that later in the video, and I've talked about it in previous videos. So you then go on to say, still quoting Mother Maria, these people become unbearable to themselves. In a most paradoxical way, they become poor from holding on to themselves. So on the subject of people becoming unbearable to themselves, I'm going to make another quotation from a talk you were giving in St. Paul's Cathedral on the 16th of April 2018, about 2 weeks before this lecture, when you said hell would be being stuck with my own memories with nothing else at all. Imagine. You know that hell is not other people. Sartre was wrong about that. Hell is me, left completely to myself, with nothing but my memories to feed on. Imagine. So you're talking about John Lennon's Imagine there, and the fact that you're an Illuminati shill and you've sold your soul to Satan and provided globalist propaganda, which has led to the deaths of millions of people and the theft of the wealth of nations. And then you've been trying to drive individuals to suicide, and you've succeeded in some cases. So you're just a catastrophe on the earth with all the problems and suffering that you personally have caused. And this is why you think that hell would be being stuck with your own memories and nothing else at all, because you're extremely narcissistic and you want to think you're superior to other people, including morally and spiritually superior to other people. And this is why you need this constant narcissistic supply. Other people telling you that you're wonderful all the time, because you've got these memories of all the evil things that you've done, and you need this constant reassurance that you're better than other people and that you're morally acceptable, which quite obviously you aren't. So that's why hell would be being stuck with your own memories. And then later on, you know that hell is not other people. Sartre was wrong about that. Hell is me, left completely to myself with nothing but my memories to feed on. So, Sartre wasn't wrong about that, because to me, hell is other people. Other people cause me hell. And when I'm left to myself, I'm perfectly happy. It's like being in heaven, compared to this continual harassment and abuse from other people. So because you're such a vile, horrible, evil person, that's why hell is your own company, because you're not getting this constant positive reinforcement from other people telling you that you're wonderful, and behaving in a deferential way towards you and this kind of thing. Whereas because I haven't got this history of persecuting other people, of lying continually and leading to all the destruction that you've caused, which I've talked about in many videos before, particularly the lies that you told about 9/11 and the London bombings and all your environmentalist propaganda. And there's an endless supply of examples I could give of this. But this is why you think Sartre was wrong. But he wasn't wrong. To some people, hell is other people, and you are one of the other people who is hell. If it weren't for people like you, then hell wouldn't be other people. So Sartre wasn't wrong, and you thought that putting me on my own and cutting me off from other people, that would be hell for me, but it isn't, because I'm not the kind of person that you are, and I don't need constant reinforcement from other people, because I've got very firm beliefs and moral values, and so I don't need constant feedback from other people telling me I'm okay or I'm wonderful or anything like that in order to feel that I'm not in hell. I can sit with my memories and I'm perfectly happy. So Sartre was right. Hell is other people. Interesting that you think he was wrong though. But that's because of your own personal character and your own behaviour. You don't understand that it's different for other people. You can't discriminate between different kinds of thing or between different kinds of person. All it is you and everything else. And everything else is just the only way that you define things and people is to as to whether they're helping you or obstructing you as you see it. So coming back again now to this lecture on the 30th of April, these people become unbearable to themselves. This is the people who care for their spiritual peace. They're locking themselves away, leads before our eyes to self-poisoning, demoralisation and loss of joy. These people become unbearable to themselves in a most paradoxical way. They become poor from holding on to themselves. They become poor from holding on to themselves. You actually repeat that line later on as well. I don't think Mother Maria was repeating it twice. I think you're repeating it twice to blame me for the situation that I'm in, because I'm refusing to allow a disgusting pervert like you to force himself on me. So I've become poor, materially speaking, because you're a pervert and you've stolen my goods and my means of supporting myself in order to try and force me to do what you want. So I haven't become poor from holding on to myself. I've become poor because you're a psychopath and a pervert and you're trying to force yourself on me. So they become poor from holding on to themselves. That's a phrase to take to bed with you, isn't it? You really say that, I'm not joking. That's a phrase to take to bed with you, isn't it? You look quite deranged when you say that as well. I don't even know what to say about it. It's so bizarre. They become poor from holding on to themselves. That's a phrase to take to bed with you, isn't it? Keep you awake, probably, as it does me. Well, I'm already awake, Rowan. I know exactly what you're up to. Keep you awake, probably, as it does me. They become poor from holding on to themselves. So you actually make a mistake there in what you're saying, because you've become so hysterical saying that's a phrase to take to bed with you, isn't it? And then you say they become poor from holding on to themselves. They become pure from holding on to themselves. That's what you really mean. That's the truth. But you're trying to put another spin on it to get your own way, because you're a psychopath and that's the only thing that matters to you. All you care about is trying to manipulate the outcome you want, and you'll say anything, you'll do anything in any given situation. It doesn't matter that you've tried the same strategy millions of times already and it hasn't got you anywhere. You're incapable of learning because you're a psychopath. So they become pure from holding on to themselves. And the effect of a certain kind of care for one's spiritual life is a loss of joy. You mean a loss of sex, don't you? Well, I shan't be having any loss of joy, because I'm going to be with my beloved very soon. As soon as you're out of the picture, and we're going to be having a really good time in each other's arms, resisting tyrannous authorities on our bed of roses, on our silk sheets. There's going to be no loss of joy. We're going to be having lots and lots of fantastic joy, and you're not getting any, mummy's boy. So just zip your trousers up and fuck off. So you then say, as I said before, she's not somebody who wants to overthrow the discipline and practice and the richness of the liturgical life that she has as a Russian Orthodox Christian. So why would she, if she was a Russian Orthodox Christian, why would you even suggest that she might want to overthrow the discipline and practice and the richness of the liturgical life that she has as an Orthodox Christian? Why would you even suggest that? It's quite bizarre. Quite bizarre. Those are the circles that you move in, though, aren't they? People who are acting in a deliberately subversive way. And you, particularly, because you're not actually working for the Church of England. You're not now anyway, now that you're Master of Magdalen College, Cambridge. But you're not working for Magdalen College, Cambridge, are you? And you weren't working for the Church of England or the Church in Wales. You're actually working for MI6, and acting as a subversive agent in these contexts, which are simply the mask that you're wearing. It's just the mask that you're wearing. That's what shill means, actually. A shill is somebody who appears to be working for one person or organisation, but is in fact working for someone else. And you're working for MI6. So, the fact that you need to clarify that she doesn't want to overthrow the discipline and practice and the richness of the liturgical life that she has as a Russian Orthodox Christian. Why would anyone think that she would, necessarily? I mean, so only because those are the circles that you move in, that you think you have to clarify this matter. No one else would have thought of it, probably. Or few people, anyway. So, you then say, far from it. She practiced that faithfully. She wrote about it eloquently, but she wanted to see it within the entire ecology of discipleship. You're talking about environmentalism and earth worship, aren't you? The globalist religion. So you're saying, I think here, that you didn't want to overthrow or subvert Christian faith, that you were practicing this faithfully and writing about it eloquently, but you want to see it within the entire ecology of discipleship. You want the globalist vision in there as well, don't you? You want everything. You want things that contradict each other. Far from it, she practiced that faithfully. She wrote about it eloquently, but she wanted to see it within the entire ecology of discipleship as something which had always to be realised in that non-possessiveness. Do you mean communism? That had always to be realised in that non-possessiveness with which you approach the souls and the bodies of others. Well, I don't want you approaching my soul and body, Rowan. You're absolutely nothing to do with me. Zip your trousers up, fuck off, and stop imagining that there's anything between us. There isn't. You're just a psycho-crazed stalker. You're as mad as a hatter. And when you talk about the souls of the bodies of others, I think you're talking about the souls of the feet, aren't you? You're alluding to my beloved and his magnificent feet, because you're so jealous of him, because he's just the most wonderful man ever, as well as having magnificent feet. I mean, everything about him is just so wonderful. He's nothing like you at all. So you're jealous, aren't you? He's not at all non-possessive, and he's a black belt in karate, so he'll be coming round to karate chop you if you try anything. So I wouldn't advise it, although he's quite agreeable that I can kick you in the balls with my steel toe caps on. Since you're into S&M, I've made this magnanimous offer several times. You're into S&M, I really want to kick you in the balls, so it's win-win. And I can't imagine why you're so reticent about inviting me. Anyway, that's the end of my video for today. But don't forget to be alert, because I will be turning up to make a citizen's arrest for terrorism. And also to ask you those awkward questions that I've still got up my sleeve. And so I shall be putting my video together now, so I can be dreaming about my beloved all night long and his wonderful souls. Souls of his feet. And his wonderful body. And everything about him is just so wonderful. He's nothing like you. And I'm sure your wife is dreaming about her hot, sexy Rastafarian boyfriend and his magnificent souls as well. So we've got a lot in common. Apart from the fact that she decided to have a relationship with you and I didn't. You're just a nutcase who's been stalking me. So on that note, I'll leave it there. But once again, don't forget to be alert. Because I will be turning up to make that citizen's arrest for terrorism. Hasta la próxima.
And she says that if you attempt to hold on to your inner life at the expense of this openness. I don't like it. If you love me, love me, love me, I'll drive you crazy. And she says that if you attempt to hold on to your inner life at the expense of this openness, we know what this idea leads to. We know what this idea leads to. We know the egoism that can reign in the world. I control all your thoughts and all your moves. I'm in the Illuminati. I'm in the Illuminati. I'm in the Illuminati. know the egoism that can reign in the world. We know how peoples care for their spiritual peace. We know how peoples care for their spiritual peace. They're locking themselves away. All about my dough, but I don't even check the peephole. So you could keep knocking, but won't knock me down. No love lost, no love found. They're locking themselves away, leads before our eyes to self-poisoning. They're locking themselves away, leads before our eyes to self-poisoning. Demoralization, loss of joy. They're locking themselves away, leads before our eyes to self-poisoning, demoralization, loss of joy. These people become unbearable to themselves.
Hell would be, and I'm not committing myself, unlike the Pope, not committing myself on this subject. Hell would be being stuck with my own memories with nothing else at all.
Gosh.
Imagine that, you know, that hell is not other people. Sartre was wrong about that. Hell is me left completely to myself with nothing but my memories to feed on. Imagine.
Yeah. That's very good. Imagine there's no heaven.
These people become unbearable to themselves. In a most paradoxical way, they become poor from holding on to themselves.
What care I for my house and land? What care I for my treasures, oh? What care I for my new wedded lord? I'm off with the raggle-taggle gypsies, oh.
In a most paradoxical way, they become poor from holding on to themselves. They become poor from holding on to themselves. It's a phrase to take to bed with you, isn't it?
Hello, hello, baby, I have only got one call. I have been arrested and I'm in a jail cell. What did you say, God? I hate AT&T. Come on, break me out of here. Now can you free me?
What did you say? Oh, you're breaking up on me. Sorry, I cannot hear you. I'm kind of busy.
They become poor from holding on to themselves. They become poor from holding on to themselves. It's a phrase to take to bed with you, isn't it? Keep you awake, probably, as it does me. They become pure. 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 Poor from holding on to themselves. And the effect of a certain kind of care for one's spiritual life is a loss of joy. They become pure, poor from holding on to themselves. And the effect of a certain kind of care for one's spiritual life is a loss of joy. As I said before, she's not somebody who wants to overthrow the discipline and practice.
I want some nice boobs, but...
As I said before, she's not somebody who wants to overthrow the discipline and practice, the richness of the liturgical life that she has as a Russian Orthodox Christian. Far from it. She practiced that faithfully. She wrote about it eloquently. But she wanted to see it within the entire ecology of discipleship.
I want to be a tree.
As I said before, she's not somebody who wants to overthrow the discipline and practice, the richness of the liturgical life that she has as a Russian Orthodox Christian. Far from it. She practiced that faithfully. She wrote about it eloquently. But she wanted to see it within the entire ecology of discipleship as something which had always...
I want some nice boobs, but...
But she wanted to see it within the entire ecology of discipleship as something which had always to be realized in that non-possessiveness with which you approached the souls and the bodies of others.
There's nothing left to try. There's no place left to hide. There's no greater power than the power of goodbye.
That night when the Lord came home inquiring of his lady, oh, The servants said on every hand, she's gone with the raggle-tackle gypsies, oh.
The footman memorized the number, but the prince still holds both the slippers. And would you leave a palace for a bedsit and Canterbury tales?
Sex.
Oh, what care I for my house and my land? What care I for my money? Oh, I'd rather have a kiss from the wild gypsy's lips. I'm away with the raggle-taggle gypsy.
I'm away with the raggle-taggle gypsy.
I'm away with the raggle-taggle gypsy. Oh.